So full disclosure, I'm not actually a marine scientist. I'm actually trained as an aerospace engineer. And for as long as I can remember, I've always wanted to be an astronaut. So if you can't recognize me in this photo, I'm suspended in microgravity, waiting for this very handsome mustachioed gentleman to whirl me around on the Vomit Comet. And for several years now, I've stopped looking for life in outer planets and have started instead to focus on the life that we have much closer to home in the oceans. And what you'll notice is that this footage is not actually a star field. This is what 400 meters deep in Monterey Bay might look like. And so what you'll also notice is, unlike our search for life in outer planets, you know, the ocean is just teeming with life, and there's a lot that we don't know about that life. And so members of my lab at the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute does a combination of approaches that involved innovative observation platforms, which is largely robotics-based, as well as state-of-the-art instrumentation, particularly imaging tools. And then finally, utilizing access to novel study systems with ocean-going research vessels. And what we do is we combine all of these things to study organisms or animals in their natural environment in the deep sea. But the reason why we do this is that ultimately we'll want to apply these lessons learned to bio-inspired design, which is, you know, the concept of developing new tools and technology based on what we learn from deep sea animals. And a lot like how, you know, we humankind have been inspired by birds to fly, there might be something that we might be inspired to do by organisms in the deep sea that we know almost nothing about. And so I work in the midwater of the ocean, and animals are weird and wacky, like this one, the anglerfish, and it has a bioluminescent lure, and this is a cystosoma, and these animals are being studied because of their transparent tissues as well as their complex visual systems for a variety of different science and engineering applications. This is actually a siphonophore, and some siphonophores can get longer than a blue whale. And they undergo these long-distance vertical migrations, and we're not sure how they do it. And then finally, this is the Humboldt squid. And these animals are voracious predators, and their soft bodies and dual modes of propulsion are actually forcing us to rethink how we develop underwater vehicles as we study and want to continue studying the deep sea. So how do we do that? All of this footage was collected because of the infrastructure investments we'd made at our institution, like an ocean-going research vessel, as well as large-scale robots, in this case, a remotely operated vehicle. In addition to that, my team also develops new imaging devices, including a laser imaging instrument called DPIV. And we've used that on a variety of different organisms that enables a completely new way of viewing or observing these animals. And one of these animals are the giant larvations, which you see here. So you'll notice that the animal is what's wagging or pumping its tail, and that structure around the animal is a mucus house. So it's made out of mucus that the animal secretes and serves as a filtration structure to separate particles in food from the animal and the water around it. And these animals can be about 10 centimeters in length, and their houses can be up to a meter in size. And the way we go about doing these kinds of experiments is we go to sea on a research vessel, and that includes, you know, the science team, the ROV pilots, as well as, you know, obviously the ship's crew. And we, the science team and the ROV pilots, sit in a very fancy control room that looks a lot like a movie theater. And in order to do these kinds of measurements, an ROV pilot is maneuvering a remotely operated vehicle to an animal of interest. And the ship's crew and the ROV pilots communicate constantly to ensure that, you know, they're dealing with a different environment and the ROV isn't being pulled off the target of interest. And once we see an animal that we're interested in studying, then the ROV pilot positions the vehicle such that our laser light on our instrument, which is a millimeter thick, so a millimeter thick laser sheet on an animal that's approximately 2 centimeters wide at a depth anywhere from 50 to 400 meters. So it's incredibly difficult. And so what I want to show you then is a result of some of this work. This is some raw footage from an ROV in Ambari. What you'll notice, and think about this as kind of an X-ray image, right? You can see inside the house of the larvation as well as the larvation. And as the animal starts beating its tail, you'll notice that the house, that outer structure there, is inflating. And you can also see particles that are moving in and around the animal and through the house. And so we've actually been able to, you know, use these measurements to measure directly the filtration rates that these animals are able to process water, and in some cases at up to 80 liters per hour. And the implications of that is in Monterey Bay, at least in their principal depth range from 200 to 400 meters, they could fully process that principal depth range within 2 weeks, which is incredibly important when you're thinking about how these organisms are interacting with their environment. But also we can use the deep PIV instrument in a scanning fashion. So a lot like an MRI, where you might have a stack of images to represent, you know, different planes along a body or a brain, we can do the same thing with a deep PIV instrument, where now instead you're seeing a scan of the larvation house as well as the larvation. And so using that image stack, what we can do and see for the first time is not only the external structures of the house, but also what looks like inside. So you're getting a particle eye view of what's inside these houses. You know, notice all of these chambers, these finger-like chambers, where every single one of those chambers wind up going to the mouth of the animal. So they're incredibly beautiful, incredibly complex structures, and we really don't know much, not only about the structure, we're just starting to scratch the surface of it, but also its function. And so what we're hoping is with this work and continued efforts, someday we might have a new class or innovated filtration system that can filter particles on a submicron scale. And so with that, I want to end on a positive note, right? And I think what's really exciting right now is there's so many great new technologies and tools that are going to be focused on studying midwater, which is the final frontier on our planet. And with exploration, we're going to be learning things that will then inspire us to do a variety of different things, things we don't even know anything about, and potentially create innovations that will forever change our world. Thank you.